Let us continue the story about the horribly good Bertha in the lesson, The Storyteller Part 2. The story so far. There were three small children on a trip with their aunt. In a train, they are in one compartment. There is a bachelor there. The aunt is not able to control the children because they are tired of sitting for so long. And they are moving around and asking questions which the bachelor finds very irritating. The aunt tries to tell them a story to keep them quiet, but it's very unsuccessful because she is not a good storyteller. Finally, the bachelor interferes and tries to tell them a story so that they will be occupied and not make a nuisance of themselves. The Storyteller Part 2. She was so good, continued the bachelor, that she won several medals for goodness, which she always wore pinned onto her dress. There was a medal for obedience, another medal for punctuality, and a third for good behavior. They were large metal medals and they clicked against one another as she walked. No other child in the town where she lived had as much as three medals. So everyone knew she must be an extra good child. Horribly good, quoted Cyril. Everybody talked about her goodness and the prince of the country got to hear about it and he said that as she was so good, she might be allowed once a week to walk in his park, which was just outside the town. It was a beautiful park, and no children were ever allowed in it. So it was a great honor for Bertha to be allowed to go there. So the bachelor continues his story in the train. He says that this child, Bertha, she was extra good and she won three medals for her goodness, one for obedience, that is always obeying her elders, teachers, whoever, another for being punctual, always being on time, and third for generally being polite and very good. And now she wore those three medals on her dress wherever she went, and everywhere she walked, those medals clicked against one another. And no other child had received so many medals. So when people seen three medals, they knew that she was an extra good child. Now Cyril is still very impressed by those two words, horribly good. And so he says them again. The bachelor continues that everyone talked about Bertha's goodness. Now the prince, the son of a king, he got to hear about it and he said that if Bertha was so good, then she needed to be rewarded and therefore he would allow her to go once a week to his park. And his park was just outside the town where they stayed. No children were allowed there. So it was a great honor, a respect, a kind of a respect or credit for Bertha to be allowed to go to that park. Were there any sheep in the park? Demanded Cyril. No, said the bachelor. There were no sheep, but there were other small, harmless animals in the park. And the storyteller paused to let the full idea of the park's treasures sink into the children's imagination, and then he resumed. Bertha was rather sorry to find that there were no flowers in the park. She had promised her aunts with tears in her eyes that she wouldn't pick any of the kind prince's flowers, and she meant to keep her promise. So, of course, it made her feel silly to find that there were no flowers to pick. Why weren't there any flowers? Again a question. Because the animal had eaten them all, said the bachelor promptly. The bachelor has very immediate and good answers to give the children. The gardeners had told the prince that you couldn't have animals and flowers, so he decided to have animals and no flowers. There was a murmur of approval. The children are very, accepting the excellent decision of the prince. And so many people would have decided to have flowers and not animals. This is their thinking. So again, were there any sheep in the park? Still stuck on to that sheep, the question of the sheep, because his aunt had not answered him properly. But the bachelor gives answers very promptly or immediately. He says, no, there were no sheep, but there were other small animals like rabbit, goat, etc. Now the storyteller, he waits, the bachelor waits, and he, lets the children imagine how many animals and how beautiful the park may have been. And then he resumes his story. He says that when Bertha went there, she was sorry to find that there were no flowers. Okay, there were only animals there. Because when she was coming to the park, her aunts told her, please do not pick any flowers from the garden, from the park there. Okay, this is the prince's park. So she had tears in her eyes, but she promised her aunts, I will not pick any of the prince's flowers. Okay, but when she went there, she saw there were no flowers. Okay, again, one more question. Why weren't there flowers? Animals had eaten them all, the bachelor says. Okay, and the gardeners had told that the prince that either you have animals or you have flowers. So the children are very happy now with this story. Let's continue. There were lots of other delightful things in the park. There were ponds with gold and blue and green fish in them, and trees with beautiful parrots that said clever things at a moment's notice, and hummingbirds that hummed all the popular tunes of the day. Imagine to go to such a park where there are so many delightful, happy things. Okay? Small bodies of water called ponds, having gold, blue, green fish, trees with parrots. And these parrots were saying clever things. Hummingbirds that hummed, all the popular songs of the day. Now Bertha walked up and down and enjoyed herself immensely and thought to herself, if I were not so extraordinarily good, I should not have been allowed to come into this beautiful park and enjoy all that there is to be seen in it. And her three medals clinked against one another as she walked and helped to remind her how very good she really was. Now Bertha's enjoying herself immensely means a lot. And she thought to herself, if I were not so good, would I have been allowed to come to this park? And her three medals clicked as she walked, and she was reminding herself, I am very good, I am very good. Now just then, an enormous or huge wolf came prowling, very slowly walking into the park to see if he could catch a fat little animal for its supper. Supper meaning dinner. The first thing that it saw in the park was Bertha. Her pinafore was so spotlessly white. Pinafore is a sleeveless garment worn over a girl's dress. You can see in the picture the white garment, sleeveless one, worn over her pink dress. Okay, and it is so white that the wolf could see it from a great distance. Bertha saw the wolf and saw that it was stealing towards her. And she began to wish that she had never been allowed to come to the park. She ran as hard as she could, and the wolf came after her with huge leaps and bounds. She managed to reach a shrubbery of myrtle bushes, and she hid herself in one of the thickest of the bushes. The wolf came sniffing among the branches its black tongue lolling out of its mouth and its pale grey eyes glaring with rage. Bertha was terribly frightened, and she thought to herself, "If I had not been so extraordinarily good, I should have been safe in the town at this moment." However, the scent of the myrtle was so strong that the wolf could not sniff out where Bertha was hiding, and the bushes were so thick that he might have hunted about in them for a long time without catching sight of her. So he thought he might as well go off and catch a little animal instead. Now Bertha was trembling so much at having the wolf prowling and sniffing so near her, and as she trembled, the medal for obedience clinked against the medals for good conduct and punctuality. So Bertha sees the wolf stealing or moving secretly towards her, and she thinks to herself, "Why was I so good? If I was not so good, I wouldn't be in this park." So she starts running as hard as she could, means as fast as she could. But the wolf came behind her with leaps and bounds, means a wolf can run much faster than Bertha. Now she managed to reach a shrubbery, you know, a place in the garden full of bushes, and they were myrtle bushes. Okay, she hid herself in a thick bush. The wolf came sniffing, smelling, trying to find her, where she is, its black tongue out of its mouth, its eyes so angry, you know, it's because it looked at its dinner in the form of Bertha, and now he can't find her. Now the myrtle bushes, they give a particular scent or a smell, okay, and this, because of this, Bertha couldn't be smelt out. Okay, she was hiding there, the bushes were thick. So the wolf thinks to himself, okay, I won't be able to catch her. I might as well go and catch another small animal for my food. But what happened was Bertha was trembling. She was shivering so much with the fright of the wolf so close to her that one of her medals clinked against the other medals, and there was a sound. The wolf was just moving away when he heard the sound of the medals clinking and stopped to listen. They clinked again in a bush quite near him. He dashed into the bush, his pale grey eyes gleaming with ferocity and triumph, and dragged Bertha out and devoured her to the last morsel. All was left of her were her shoes, bits of clothing, and the three medals for goodness. Now, when the wolf heard the sound of the medals clinking, he stopped, listened. He knew exactly that Bertha was in a bush next to him. So he dashed into the bush, his eyes gleaming, shining with violence and victory. He found his, you know, supper. He dragged Bertha out. He ate hungrily, quickly, and every last piece or amount of food. Nothing was left, only her shoes, clothing, and her three medals. The story began badly, said the smaller of the small girls, but it had a beautiful ending. Now the smaller girl is appreciating that it was a bad story in the beginning, but the ending was beautiful. The bigger of the girl says, "It is the most beautiful story I have ever heard." With immense decision, she has made a decision, you know, big decision, most beautiful story. And Cyril says that it was the only beautiful story that he had ever heard. A dissentient opinion came from the aunt. "A most improper story to tell young children. You have undermined the effect of years of careful teaching." "At any rate," said the bachelor, collecting his belongings preparatory to leaving the carriage, I kept them quiet for 10 minutes, which was more than you were able to do. Unhappy woman, he observed to himself as he walked down the platform of Templecombe station. For the next 6 months or so, those children will assail her in public with demands for an improper story. So when he finishes his story, there was a dissentient or an opinion which was not very good from the aunt. She tells him that this is not a proper story and that he has weakened the effect of years of careful teaching. We don't tell stories of death and animals eating human beings to children. But the bachelor was a young man. He just left as he was leaving, you know, in preparation to leaving his carriage. He says, whatever it is, I kept them quiet. You were not able to do that. And he walks down, he goes out of his carriage and he says to himself, what an unhappy woman. Now, after I have told him this story, these children are going to trouble her or assail her in public whenever they travel with her for demands for not a proper story, but an improper story like The Bachelors. Now, this story has been written by H.H. Munro, or he writes by the name Saki. For which three values did Bertha win medals? What was exceptional about it? Bertha won medals for obedience, punctuality, and good behavior. No other child in the town had won so many medals. Now, these are questions from your textbook. Okay, you can read through and get an idea of what answers you are supposed to write. Next, why was the wolf unable to trace Bertha? The scent of the myrtle or the smell of the myrtle was very strong and the bushes were very thick. So the wolf wasn't able to trace Bertha. What gave Bertha away? Gave Bertha away means what? How was she found? And how did she meet her end means how was she killed? Next, what impact did the story have on children? Impact meaning what effect did the story have on the children? Why was the aunt annoyed at the bachelor for telling them an improper story? So this is just a reference for you to understand what you have to answer to each question. And H.H. Munro stands for Hector Hugh Munro, alias Saki. He's a short story writer. And an alias is a false or an assumed identity. Many writers use this.